What's up, guys, and welcome back to the Game Show Global Esports Cup. We have a three-set day where SVW, the team that are currently unmarked, are going to be going up against three teams, starting with CIS Rejects, probably the hardest since they're still on top of everything. They have yet to lose a single match here, so good luck to SVW. I'm Mike Loris, going to be joined by Danley Casts as well as Corrupt Drop Bear on the stats. It's 0.85 time. I know very little about this patch.
Did you read the patch notes? Everyone's screaming Ogre Magi. No? I just see everyone screaming Ogre Magi and Spectre. You know why Ogre Magi.
Dude, I mean, he got one more armor. Literally can't kill him anymore. He was already, seven armor or something stupid like that?
Yes.
Like, why would you give him more?
Well, think about it, though. He's like an Earthshaker. He's a melee hero. He has to be pretty close to land his stun. So I think giving him more survivability, it's something that will help him, but it's also making the hero close to broken, if we have to say anything, because he already has such a high HP pool. Now you're making him really tanky. How do you deal with an Ogre Magi at level 1, 2, or 3? But, did you also see he can buff towers now?
Yeah, that's nice, but I think that's kind of more of a side cool thing, as opposed to like a really practical thing. Like, as Ogre Magi, your game plan is going to be kill people early on with your Ignite and your Fire Blast. You want to be super aggro since you're so tanky, you could take all those shots. Bloodlusting the tower comes in later on as kind of like a late game backup thing if you fall behind. Yeah, it's very nice, but I don't think that's really a super compelling reason to pick him up. At least not, not on top of the existing reasons to pick him up.
I don't really think you need to use it for the late game, though. Think about it. It means that picking up Bloodlust at level 1, 2, or 3 is a little bit more viable. Because imagine you're going up against, you could say, a try versus try, and you're being dived onto your tower. You Bloodlust the tower, it's hitting a little bit faster, but it could make the difference between a kill or just pushing them back. So there's a lot you can do with it, but I don't think it's the thing that's going to make Ogre Magi insanely broken. It's just that armor that we mentioned.
I still think it's just you don't really want to be getting Bloodlust unless you have some insane synergies. We saw, Ogre Magi, Juggernaut, Magnus a couple of patches ago. Like, that type of thing. Yeah, that makes, obviously, Bloodlust a lot more practical. But, yeah, I just think that if you're going to be in a 3v3 situation as Ogre Magi, your tower should not be pushed in. You should be on the aggressive. Otherwise, you're probably doing it wrong. But it seems like we have ourselves some new bands. Some old faces, obviously, Bounty Hunter and Lina. But Lishrak is namely still in the pool. His damage output got slashed. So I'm pretty sure SVW are going to be a little more hesitant to pick that one up.
I think it's not just the damage, though, because you also have to consider that there's a lot of items that got nerfed, in particular Bloodstone. So Bloodstone being a core item on Lina, on Storm Spirit, and Lishrak, having the main thing about Bloodstone nerfed means that these heroes aren't really going to be viable anymore. I'm surprised they decided to ban Lina, because she received quite a few nerfs herself, plus obviously Bloodstone's going to hurt her the most, but they're still in last patch, so Leshrac's still going to be strong. Oh, my dog is barking.
That's my thing.
Yeah.
Tell your dog to stop.
It's my thing now, but Oh, wow, we're going to see Nightstalker first up by CAS Rejects. I really like this. They're really moving along into the next patch. Did Nightstalker get a buff?
I think he got the Ogre Magi regen. Like, Ogre Magi lost his regen or something like that, and Nightstalker was the one to get it. I don't remember there being anything else. We're going to be talking about this quite a bit. I'm just actually going to pull it up right now so I know exactly what I'm talking about. Let's see, where's
That's
Nightstalker
good.
Here? That is not Nightstalker. Okay, apparently my Control F is broken or something like that. But yeah, I don't think Nightstalker really got that many nerfs. Yeah, just Baith's health regen from 0.25 to 2. So this guy is going to be regenerating really quickly. Nightstalker is the type of hero that you want to have really quickly regenerating. I don't know how much it's actually going to matter, but when Nightstalker is very often level 3, level 4 by the end of the first night, the extra regen certainly does a lot.
Well, I love it, because the other hero that has the regen, like Nightstalker now, is Nyx Assassin, and both of these heroes have something in common. They're supposed to be roaming around and helping their team, right? So having extra regen, it's super useful. So I like how CIS Rejects is going along with this, but I'm pretty sure they're glad that they picked this up as well after seeing a Leshrac pick, because once Leshrac is silenced, he is so squishy, that he's gonna melt with a Night Stalker plus one. So I have no issues with this Night Stalker pick as of yet. They will be going up against a Darkseer,
Five
but he
seconds
shouldn't be too much
remaining.
of an issue for the Shadowfiend Night Stalker.
Darkseer just probably gonna go towards that
It is half
offlane
time.
normal patch stuff, so yeah, you'd expect that. And Nightstalker is okay versus a Darkseer. Void, obviously, not that great versus Surge, but Crippling Fear, as long as you're an Intelligencer, as long as you're relying on any sort of mini combo like Vacuum Wall or Lishrak Split Earth into Lightning Storm, then Nightstalker is just a very, very disruptive
Radiant
hero with that
Team
Crippling
Ban.
Fear, which a lot of people like tend to underestimate. It's really stupidly broken. Like 50% chance to miss is already pretty insane. Add a huge silence on top of that, you get into some really crazy territory. But either way, we're gonna have a Dazzle being banned out along with that
10 seconds
Huskar. Yeah, it seems like with
remaining.
Lishrak Darkseer, you really don't want to be going up against the Huskar.
Yeah,
Five seconds
there's no problem
remaining.
with that. Huskar and Dazzle Burn. I'm surprised I decided to ban both, but that's
Reserve
okay.
time.
Huskar didn't really get touched by the nerfs, did he? I know Darkseer got a nerf because I made a little funny comment about him when I was reading the patch. He got a little bit dumber. I think he lost 2 intel or something. 2 int gain, or was it 2 int gain or 2 int in total?
Base.
I don't know.
His
Was
base
it two
intelligence
base?
minus two, yeah. So he starts out
Yeah.
dumber, but I don't really think. I mean, those like stat tweaks is those are the type of things that you don't really think are gonna have a huge impact. But maybe there's something like he can't cast a Surge and two Ion Shells
Radiant
anymore
team
or something like
pick.
that. I haven't done the math, but anyway, we have a Gyrocopter being panned out. This is, I'm pretty sure, some of the first games that these teams are playing on this patch, at least in this type of more competitive environment. So probably they'll just fall back a little bit on what they know, but we see Nightstalker being picked up first, and that was not really a thing in the last patch. Unless you're Walrus Punch, Screen Squad, then you would probably go ahead and do it. But Xerneas Rejects, they have the Nightstalker. How deep do they want to
10
go in this
seconds
aggressive play
remaining.
style? Going to the Lishrak with Nightstalker is certainly very viable, but
5 seconds
you might want to have
remaining.
someone else join that party. Undying,
Undying
there we go, there's some aggro.
awaits. Didn't
Dying
Undying get
team.
nerfed to the ground, though? I had a couple of people comment and say that the hero is almost trash. Let me just read this. His tombstone, yeah, it takes 3 attacks to kill the tombstone.
Yeah,
At level
that
one.
it did get like some scaling issues, so like early on it's easier to kill, and later on it's like kind of harder to kill if you're like, I mean, Darkseer, Lishrak don't really auto attack things. He did get quite a bit of nerfs, like the zombies are weaker and stuff like that, but still, like,
Five
the
seconds
idea of this here, the
remaining.
underlying aspect of I'm gonna pick an Undying, I'm gonna swing the HP pool in my favor, and then use the high
Reserve
damage heroes of
time.
Nightstalker and Shadowfiend to actually kill you off afterwards. That
Venturing
still
back,
stands.
sir.
So, yeah, I mean, like, nerfs
Radiant
or
team
not, the game
pick.
plan with the Undying is certainly here for Xerneas Rejects. They're looking to apply
Lion.
pressure, and now they grab a Lion, so
Dire team
Undying and
pick.
Nightstalker, and now a Lion should be an Undying going towards the offlane, it seems.
I'm a little bit concerned with CIS Rejects. How are they going to lane these heroes? Because they've picked up a Lion, which is a very, very level dependent support. They have a Night Stalker, which we don't know yet if this is supposed to be that position 4 roaming Night Stalker, or if it's supposed to be that position 3 or even a position 2 Night
Ten
Stalker. So
seconds
I want to
remaining.
say his role is still in the
Winter
dark.
Wyvern.
Shadowfiend, he's going to be getting farmed, so
Radiant
he's
team
obviously going to be
back.
that priority. But yeah, and just splitting the farm between a Night Stalker, Undying, and Lion, plus whatever hero is going to come in last. I'm hoping this is a support, then at least they're going to be able to distribute farm between those three heroes a little bit more nicely. Or if they want to
Ten
put Undying
seconds
as a position
remaining.
four, then my concerns will be with them for the rest of the game
Five
until we
seconds
figure out what's
remaining.
going on.
It is Undying Nightstalker, double melee. Juggling the farm here is going to be hard for
Reserve
CIS
time.
Rejects, but
Ten
for
seconds
SVW,
remaining.
they have a lot more of a standard previous patch thing going on. You got the Winter
Five
Wyvern for the
seconds
defensive power. In
remaining.
fact, with the Darkseer, it will be, in certain portions of the game, very hard for CIS Rejects to get these kills through the Embrace, through the Surge.
Dire team
And of course,
back.
Phantomlancer has Doppelganger, so they're going to have the late game scaling in the PL and Lishrak. That is quite a bit of late game damage that CIS Rejects really aren't working with. CS Rejects have to go for this sort of timing play within the first couple of nighttime phases. They have to take a really decisive lead.
10 seconds
Otherwise,
remaining.
Nightstalker falls off really hard, Undying falls off really hard. They still provide utility and a good
5 seconds
portion of utility at that,
remaining.
but with Shadowfiend as the only damage dealer, they're gonna have to grab some damage here, I
Radiant
feel.
team
Sven
pick.
stands ready.
Oh, okay. Well, there's your damage. It's going to be that
Five
Sven
seconds
pickup by
remaining.
CIS Rejects, but this pushes them towards a 3 melee lineup, and you don't really want to have this when you're going up against a Darkseer just because Ion Shell hurts like hell, and Leshrac is AoE galore. So it could work out. I can see this as a bum rush lineup, honestly, if you look at their draft. They got Nightstalker that doesn't really need much. You have a Sven that's going to give armor and some cheap damage. Shadow Fiend, once he just gets a mechanism, he's pretty
10
much good to
seconds
go. And then
remaining.
you have the Undying for that team fight crowd control. So I
5
feel this game is
seconds
going to probably
remaining.
finish at around the 20-minute mark with how they've drafted this, or if it goes according to plan. It could go later,
Three
more or
seconds
less. It
left.
depends on how the Dire decides to defend this out.
Yeah, probably if it does get beyond that point, then it's going to be a lot harder for CIS Rejects to actually close out the game. This is where Warcry is actually Sven's probably one of his more useful assets. Just willing to dive towers with Undying and Nightstalker obviously protects you a little bit more from those tower shots. Sven did get Darkseer's Intelligence. He got +2 to his base int, and that helps actually quite a bit. Sven is not really a super mana rich hero. We have a Queen of Pain as the last pick for the SVW side. This is, well, a pretty greedy lineup for SVW also. Like Queen of Pain, Lestrak, yeah, they do well early on, but how are these lanes actually going to go down? Because Lestrak, Darkseer, Queen of Pain, and PL all need their farm, and Winter Wyvern, probably not the only support, or at least I would hope not.
Do you think this is actually going to be a support Lashrak this game? Because with the heroes that they currently have, they have four heroes that can do well with farm, but one of them has to transition into a support role just because there's not enough farm on the map. And I think I may have just been given an error. See,
Yeah, me too,
flattened
like a decode or
serializer.
whatever.
Yep, well, we both got it apparently, so they're both going to get kicked out or.
C flatten, serializer, decode array index, 8 out of range 0. So if anyone can tell me what that means, that'll be great, but oh, there goes Dota. Valve!
Just reborn things. Just reborn things. Oh, well, here we go.
That was
Well,
definitely
that's
Dota,
great.
right? Like where everyone still hears us, probably. We're good on that account.
Yeah. But the last pick, Queen of Pain, I read the nerfs to Queen of Pain. She is still a strong hero, but not as strong as she used to be.
Yeah, it was
But I'm very
just
surprised that
Sonic
they still
Wave damage
decided to go
got
for
touched
her.
up.
But that's the bread and butter for Queen of Pain. You want to burst people down with that.
It is going to be slightly harder for a co-op, but I mean, she is a hero that is just inherently a little bit more survivable than some others, and if you are going to be expecting lots of dives, Queen of Pain or any sort of hero with any sort of survivability tool, that blink is going to be invaluable. Even though she is going to be doing less damage, it looks like we are the only ones who actually got disconnected. Everyone else is playing normally.
No, drop their DC. So it was
I
everyone in
mean,
our
all the
channel.
players are still here. That's just
Well,
not
that's
fair, man.
good. That's
Either
good.
way,
And
looks
all
like
the casters. All the casters, because
Distract.
Blackbeard just reconnected as well. So
God
it was
damn it,
just the
Valve. Oh,
casters.
I got it
Oh my
again.
god, I got it again? Oh,
Okay.
great. Well, I think we're not
Well, I guess we're gonna
destined
have the
to
day off since
cast
we
this
clearly can't play this
game.
game. So, guys, I think we should, instead of talk about this game because we can't play it, we should talk about the new patch in general. I'm kind of
Well,
surprised
that's
that they removed
awesome.
Terrorblade, honestly. I don't think any people would really
<Moved
notice. I saw that, I'm like,
in.
remove Terrorblade from Captain's Mode. It's like, oh yeah, he was in Captain's Mode, wasn't he?
Did they actually change him at all to justify
After I saw
being.
that he was removed, I just stopped reading because I was like, oh, this is not something I need to know right now.
So
Reflection is
doesn't
now
that mean that
AoE.
he's. Oh, yes,
Reflection
okay,
cooldown
that's what's ha. Okay.
rescaled.
Okay, that's why. I was playing 10v10 today and I was wondering why everyone near Terrorblade was getting illusions when he casted that. It was so strange. I was like, what the hell is this?
Conjure image
There
is
are a lot of
actually
things.
like the enemies know that it's an illusion also.
Up in the top lane. Oh, I'm in game. I don't know if you're in game
I
yet,
just
but
got in, but I don't
Nightstalker.
have high hopes for staying in here. Let's
I
introduce
don't.
who's gonna be playing what, because that might be the only thing we're allowed to do. We got Goretz playing the Nightstalker for the SCIS Rejects offlane. Always wanna fly, he's roaming around as the Undying. Got Iceberg playing his Shadow Fiend down towards bottom lane. It's Vanxcore and Arties and the Lion and Sven respectively. They're gonna try to go for top, actually, at least aggressively position themselves towards his PL. And the support Leshrac is not something we see, especially nowadays, but versus Nightstalker Undying, you really don't wanna have a support Leshrac on your side.
He's got a great skill set to be a support, and actually, they're going to try and jump onto Fly. I think Fly's going to be in a lot of trouble here. He's only got a decay, but unfortunately, still on cooldown. First blood going in the way of the Dire. They're going to enjoy this, but Noctis being chased up by a very, very angry Nightstalker. I'll introduce the Dire. We have Eren playing on the Phantom Lancer. He's farming all right. a Nosik. Nokic? I'm going to presume this is Nosik on the Winter Wyvern. We have Akella playing on our support Lashrak. In the mid lane, we've got Yudin over on our Queen of Pain. And lastly, down towards the bottom, we have Madden handling our Darkseer.
Darkseer is doing just fine down this bottom lane. We'll get pushed out occasionally by the Lion, but it should be overall just fine to sit there and farm. Same thing with the Shadow Fiend, really. It's up towards top where you would expect the most action to occur. I like how they get the kill with the Lashrak. As soon as I say Lashrak is a bad support hero in this environment, with only level 1 Undying, level 3 Nightstalker, the heroes are definitely not at their strongest at this stage. Undying really does need those extra bits of levels, but the Lashrak is typically pretty clunky. Split Earth somehow did land there, but level 1 Split Earth has such a small circle, and not doing a ton of damage versus like these tanky-oriented heroes like Nightstalker and Undying, he might just get run over after he throws out his kit.
Yeah, and considering that, as you said, he's going to be in that support role, he's going to be very squishy, so he will be a high priority target. You don't really want to leave him in the fight just because he's going to keep on throwing the lightning bolt and lightning storm out anyway. So we'll see how the Lashrak does this game, if he manages to get a lot of farm in the supporting role or if he's going to be in a bit of trouble. Akella, they're just going to keep on throwing out the lightning and being super annoying. But for the moment, we look at the CS charts and CIS rejects, they are dominating all of their lanes.
This is what we've seen from them in pretty much all of their past games. They would die a couple of times, but they would have so much CS that would almost seem like the deaths were just, you know, tokens for the other team to just have a chance in the game. It's, you know, one
bottom lane?
Kill up bottom lane. There goes Darkseer. Stormhammer gonna blow him up. 240 mana pool. It looks like the 2 int actually isn't gonna help the Sven too much, at least no like double Stormhammer at level 1.
I think he'd be too broken if he had double Stormhammer though.
Oh yeah.
He's such a good hero. So you just, I like how Ice Frog's just how he balances Dota. He doesn't balance them till they're broken. Although there have been some circumstances. Tombstone's been thrown down in the top lane. They want to jump on the Wyvern. He is slowed up very, very much, and it looks like he's going to go down. No chance to go over the tree line, although Lightning's going to come out. Only a minor slow. They're going to throw the Lance as well onto the Nightstalk, but they're going to turn around. They are very tanky. There is going to be the stun connecting onto our Nightstalk. He's still tanky, surviving through everything. Pops the wand, and he's still alive. He will go down to the PL, unfortunately, but Fly, he has other things in mind, but he's got no mana, and the Tombstone is gone, so he is actually stuck in the tree line. He really wants the PL, unfortunately won't get it, and he's just gonna have to hoof it back home and hope that he doesn't die, but he shouldn't, he's fine. Self popped and PL's back to full.
So I think I saw this correctly. I think I saw the Doppelganger Illusions attack the Tombstone and count for its attack. So if that's actually by design, Undying is actually a really bad hero right now. Hopefully I saw that wrong, but your illusions are not supposed to be able to do stuff like that. They're going to try to go again for the Undying. He has no mana, no health either. With one more Arctic Burn shot, he should burn to it, and well, maybe a couple more are needed. 17 HP, there's a Doppelganger forward. Only Quantify will die up on top, but in the meantime, over towards mid, Nightstalker making his first rotation. Will miss the Queen of Pain, but does see the Courier. He is fast enough to actually kill it off. Go for the Courier, Goretz. No, why are you trying to go for the Queen of Pain? He's going to land the Void. Silence is there as well. Vanguard closing in. They're going to die the Tier 2, and they get the kill on the Queen of Pain, not taking that much damage because Nightstalker so tanky with that extra 2 regen. I feel like they probably could have gotten both the Courier and the Queen of Pain, but they get the kill on the mid lane. Iceberg already having a fantastic time, doubling up the Queen of Pain is going to have that much better of a time.
I liked the priority of the heroes. They're just saying, skip the Courier, just go straight for the Queen of Pain, make this lane a lot easier for Iceberg. So this Bum Rush draft for them, it's kind of working out. They are dying a couple of times, which is a little unfortunate, but it's got to happen, especially when you're going for this kind of style. Oh, round two. Looks like Yudinova's not going to have the best time of his life in this mid lane. Although, maybe they're going to give up. He is hanging around, he's got mana, and a mango, so they can go balls deep for this if he wants to.
Yeah, the upside of putting a Nightstalker on the offlane means that usually we see supports Nightstalkers at like level 2 at this stage. This guy's level 5, this guy is ready to rumble. And here comes the support Lashrak doing 50 damage with his Lightning Storm. That is not going to deter a Nightstalker whatsoever. Up towards top lane, always want to fly. Once again, in a little bit of trouble, Splinter Blast going to connect. He will sword himself, drop the Tombstone, but that's not going to do enough, I feel. Nightstalker is coming in very quickly, Undying, still taking a lot of damage. It looks like the Tombstone will force them all away as Nashik's going to get silenced up by Goretz. The beatdown is going to commence. The Winter Wyvern has absolutely no mana and will take a fall here. And now they're going to try to go for the Phantom Lancer. 9 seconds away from Doppelganger. They may just have enough damage to do this, although the Lance kills off the Undying before the Decay can actually be casted. And now the Night Stalker is out of mana. He will chow down on his stick charges, rather, grab the kill on the PL with a Void. And Madden's actually going to teleport up towards top way too late to help out. This Night Stalker is having a very successful first night, level 6 already.
So, can we agree that Undying's Tombstone at level 1, or not even level 1, just in general now is not that great?
Were you watching it? I wasn't watching if illusions were attacking it this time.
I didn't see illusions, but the fact that the tombstone, it just takes so much damage. I'm pretty sure it was a level 2 tombstone when that team fight happened. In the mid lane, though, it looks like we are going to have a bit of an engagement, but Tao gets denied by the Queen of Pain. Nice snipe there by Yudanova. But do you feel like Undying has just lost his touch because Tombstone got nerfed so hard? Yeah.
Mid lane bang score going to get jumped, although a very nice spike is going to connect on the 2. Splinter Blast will still slow him down. There's another Lance. They're going to try to go for Iceberg. Sonic Wave through will actually clip the Lion. It did not look like that was going to hit the Lion, but hey, double kill for Queen of Pain over in mid. And that is going to, you know, balance out the lane somewhat. But again, it's CIS Rejects to be getting so much more just last hits, raw power in these lanes that these kills just serving to keep SVW kind of in it. Always got to remember that Artis is on bottom lane. He has maxed out Hammer. He is starting to get the cleave. And he's in a 1v0 lane.
This is a Sven's dream, just to have this absolute free farm down in the, sorry, up in the top lane, though. We're gonna have Fly pursued by 3 heroes. Tombstone already killed. I think that was just all the heroes. I didn't think it was the illusions, but looks like Nightstalker might be in a bit of trouble. Slowed up by everything. Wall deployed as well. Look at the commitment to grab this kill. They will get the Nightstalker in the meantime, but what level is this Darkseer? He's level 7 and he's picked up Wall. Isn't this a little bit early to grab it?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like if you have the vacuum, you probably, at least you have a chance to kill off the Undying there as well. Wall is fine early on, but it's not really super impressive. The most depressing thing in this game is definitely this Undying. This Tombstone is just flat out terrible versus Phantom Lancer. It lasted for like 1 second, generously 1 second. You don't really want to be doing this anymore, and I'm pretty sure CIS Rejects are going to alter their game plan in the future, but for right now, 7-7, as the Night Stalker does have his ultimate up. I don't really know if there are any clear opportunities here. You can see with the vision placed, they do see the smoke, first of all. That's pretty nice, but they want to play aggressively. I don't really know if they can, simply because the Tombstone is pretty much useless at this point, and he maxed it out also.
Yeah, he was probably hoping that maxing it out meant that it was still going to be viable, but I'm pretty sure last patch, when it had a HP pool, it was much more valuable, especially for teams that had really low base damage or really slow attack speed during those early levels. So now that they see this weakness, I'm pretty sure a lot of teams are looking at this and thinking, yeah, I don't think we're going to pick Undying anymore, but look at the commitment in the top lane. 4 heroes, and are they going to really dive for Fly? He is very squishy. He's got almost no HP, although he does heal a lot of it back with the Soul Rip. Winter's Curse with the commitment as well, and they will kill him off, but there's no reinforcement by CIS Rejects. They kind of left him to die, and we had a pause, and I'm pretty sure everyone felt that.
Yeah, good. I was hoping that it was everyone, not just me, but... Okay, so that definitely confirms it. Tombstone bad up against PL, but here comes Iceberg. He has Haste and Shadow Blade. They don't know that he's here. One hit raise. That's going to get the kill. And now they're onto the supportless Shrag, who has a stun, is not going to land it. Actually, no, is. Even though he did die right before that. Sonic Wave through, though, from Yudanova is going to make the Shadow Fiend pay a price. Still, he gets 2 kills. Not a terrible trade for him. Shadowblade, Shadow Fiend, Nightstalker Undying, CS Rejects need to play a lot more aggressively. They need to get more objectives with this type of playstyle. A late game Sven, though very powerful, may run into some issues up against the Winter Wyvern.
I think it's not just the Wyvern, but also it's going to be kiting issues, because again, there's just going to be stuns and slows by Leshrac and Winter Wyvern. There's an elusive PL, and then you have the Darkseer that could just surge a target away if he's being chased by the Sven. So I'm hoping that Sven goes for a Blink Dagger at some point. That's going to be a saving grace for him, because there's not many heroes that they have that improve the gap closing. Lion going to go all in for Madden here. He's got no finger, unfortunately. He's only level 5, and he looks like he's going to get taken down by Madden. Just going to sap his mana and bop to death. What was that?
Well, the Sven was also picked off by the teleporting Queen of Pain who came in. No Sonic Wave there and wasn't even needed. So CS Rejects, again, playing how they need to, but not the right time to do it. Tower is also going to be denied. That's the second denied tower in this game for CIS Rejects. And when you're playing such a draft that really wants to top out in the 20-minute mark, the lack of gold really does hurt that much more. So it is, right now, the dire to have pretty firm control of this game.
Ooh.
They're gonna lose their courier, which kind of sucks, but didn't have anything on it, so it's not a big, huge deal.
Still a nice snipe though, just to have the extra 150 gold for everyone on your team. But I want to say that I'm pretty sure CS Rejects, they're looking at their draft and thinking, well, we're suffering from patch shock. Just so much new stuff to take in. You try and go for the stuff that was awesome last patch, and then you realize, wait, it's not viable anymore. So I wonder if they're going to adjust their play style to fit their heroes now, because Shadow Fiend's fine. It's just the Undying that they really have to play around. The hero is just so finicky now, and he's not as strong as he used to be. How would you really do this? Would you have to grab that mechanism and just go for that five-man ball so they don't focus down the tombstone?
I feel like once he realized the illusions were doing full damage to the tombstone, he should have stopped getting it. You'll slow down the PL by like 1.5 seconds. That's nothing. That's not worth your skill points, especially as a support hero. They're gonna run into the Witcher Wyvern, gets thrown up to the high ground. Tombstone, I guess, still provides some sort of deterrent if the enemy can't actually get to it, so that's kind of nice, but it's only killing Winter Wyvern right now. CS Rejects really do need to start taking some towers and actually destroy the towers, not just let them be denied. This tombstone is just, I mean, we could see like Lashrak, he's having a lot of issues or some issues dealing with this tombstone, but yeah, the Phantom Lancer is just, I don't think that's by design. They're gonna go for Udyr over towards mid. Stormhammer, couple raises, that'll kill off Queen of Pain. Mask of Madness on Sven, Shadowblade on Shadow Fiend. Let's see how much action they can get. They're going to try to go for bottom lane. Diving the tier 1 tower without the Sven here, however, is kind of risky. Doppelgang over the trees. Yurin is going to immediately get hexed up. Vanguard has Finger of Death now. Grabs level 6, but immediately gets cursed. And now the lance is going to be thrown. Vanguard is going to get dropped before he casts anything. Here comes Sven from the side, as will the Shadow Fiend. One raise, couple hits. Not going to do it with the Embrace, but they will get the kill in the end with another raise. Now Iceberg, with a double damage rune popped, is going to go for the backline.
Oh,
one hit, one
gosh.
Raise. Going to kill out the soft Lashrak. And now they're onto the Winter Wyvern, who doesn't have burn, so she is definitely gonna die here. A couple more hits from Iceberg, and Nightstalker is gonna snag that kill. This top lane tower is going to fall, and my god, Shadow Fiend, I think he's doing enough damage.
Oh, yeah, definitely doing. He's probably doing enough damage to make up for the Lion when he went back to base, considering he died, so. That's great though. That's what CIS Rejects needed. They needed a successful team fight, and doing it after killing the Queen of Pain as well meant that they didn't have to deal with that burst from the Queen. So great stuff for them to go for that sort of play.
So we've been talking a lot about the weakness of the Undying. This support Lashrak, I feel like, hasn't really been doing that much. We saw, I mean, Lashrak is paper. Everyone knows that if you ever played Lashrak ever. Do you really want to have this type of hero with no setup? Also, if they had like a Venge or a Rubick to set up for Split Earth, then aggressively I could see this working out, but this isn't really the right situation, I don't think. They're going to run to Udenova. Looks like there's no Crippling Fear in time, no big deal. But it seems like CS Rejects just want to circle around the map and take all the towers now.
Well, why not though? If you know you have the momentum and you can take these towers at a decent rate and also at a good quite easily without losing heroes, and I really do not see why not. It's going to give you a massive influx of gold. Iceberg, unfortunately, may have overextended. Dust has been popped. He's actually got no Shadow Blade anyway for 12 seconds. He does go for the ultimate to just reduce that damage incoming from the enemy team, but unfortunately, he's by himself, so he will die. Fly in the meantime, trying to save his teammate, but instead going to feed his life away, whereas Vanskor, coming in from the backside, just throws an Earth Spike and says, okay, guys, I'm done. I'm by myself. Well, the Nightstalker is going to be here as well as the Sven. Oh, are they trying to bait them on the hill? The creep almost showed them off.
Good
if Vanskor can bait this, they'll be awesome.
Good read from SVW, not going up that hill. They knew that there were enemies on the bottom lane since they were taking down the tier 2 tower. You don't really want to mess with that. That's the downside of going for aggressive playstyle. Sometimes you think you're invulnerable. And, I mean, the Shadow Fiend, though he is doing a hell of a lot of damage, doesn't really have that much HP. They're going to try to look for the Phantom Lancer down towards bottom lane. With a Blink Dagger up on Sven, it is very possible to get this kill, since even if he's in a Swarm of Illusions, you will find the real one mighty quick. And now they definitely know where the real one is. Artes has Vanguard right behind him. Finger of Death still prepped and ready. There's the Warcry. Blink forward. Stormhammer is there. Spike and Hex. It's all going to follow up if even needed. The Spike is there. Irene's actually still alive for a very long time, but Urn will eventually go down. And up towards top lane, well, always want to fly. Still sticking around. Can't really do too much because Undying is apparently really bad now. But it's still a very useful kill on the Phantom Lancer. Sven is starting to accelerate and does have items to help him accelerate and help him fight. Blink Dagger, Mask of Madness, he can get in and tear things up really quickly.
Iceberg has a invisibility rune pop, so he can go for a quick snipe onto one of these heroes if he wants to. Queen of Pain would be ideal, but there are some squishier supports who are much easier to kill. But instead, he's going to show himself, raising the creep wave. And there's a lot of dire heroes up here. They can just try and swarm all over Fly and Iceberg if they want to. And it's not going to be spotted. They have their own wards down there, so it looks like they're just going to go right onto Fly. Iceberg, who's just going to hide in the Shadow Blade. He's hanging around, though. I think it'll be much better if he just tries to go for an escape, but Winter's Curse onto the creep, and it shows Iceberg because he went under a sentry ward. They pop the wall down, and it literally hits nothing. Iceberg just going to go for the ultimate here to reduce the damage, and he's just going to kill. Oh, he actually gets a Leshrac kill, and here comes reinforcements. Vanskor, as well as Nightstalker. Heal onto Yudanova. The Queen of Pain's going to be safe. PL trying to go ham onto the Shadow Fiend. He will get him. And Nightstalk, he's just going to have to get out of here. Luckily for him, he is very fast, so he won't be an easy target. Although there is a Surge thrown out onto the PL. They see the lion instead. He's going to run into the tree line, but no TP for 36 seconds because he had the TP to that top lane. 2-for-1, only a support for a Shadow Fiend and a lion. Definitely not worth it there for CIS. Great rotation for the Dire.
Yes, SBW are just... They always have more heroes in the area than CIS rejects. As long as that's the case, as long as the Dire do have the numbers advantage, then they're going to be taking these fights pretty much no questions asked. Yes, the trade-off is that Artis is still farming on that Sven, and that's going to be inconvenient later on, but CIS rejects, their ability to fight right now, especially when Shadow Fiend is like one of the first heroes to drop, it is pretty much non-existent. Like, the Sonic Wave wasn't even used there, and it soon is going to be Aghanim, so it's going to always be available. In fact, it just has to fly out to her right now. She is going to grab it. This is not looking that great for CIS rejects, honestly. Like, this event has to get to a super bursty stage, like, you know, Daedalus, BKB, Mask of Madness type stage. Yeah, they are holding onto a gold lead right now. The experience lead is still in their favor, but I don't really know if that's going to translate well enough to them actually winning the game. The Shadow Fiend and Sven, they have to actually start working together and stop suiciding. Although they're going to run into Akela, just beat him down with the God Strength. RT's found himself a haste rune, and he's not going to get caught up to, but also Vanskor, he's going to get jumped, stuns a whole bunch of illusions, will fall in the end. Hex will buy him a little bit of time, but with the vacuum back, you know, I don't know, maybe he's going to buy some time for Iceberg to come into position. No, it's not enough. It's ultimately a one-for-one support trade.
Yeah, it looks like he was trying to go on a warding mission. He has an observer ward in his inventory, and putting one into the enemy jungle aggressively would have been cool because it means that rotations for them would be a little bit easier, knowing that they can see things, but he couldn't put it down. He gives his life away, so not that great, unfortunately. He might try and do it again sometime soon, but yeah, you mentioned this Sven. He's not that big yet. He's almost got a BKB, which is nice. But once he has this, is he just going to group up with his team and fight with them from now on? Is he supposed to just try and go for solo kills now? I don't really understand why he'll pick up a BKB unless he wants to go for that five-man push with his team.
I feel like there's a lot more upside to actually group up with your teammates and go for these kills. Over towards the Dire Jungle, it's like Lightning Strike. Shrak's going to find the Lion, but can't really do that much against him, not by himself. They lose the Nightstalker up on the top lane, who is very close to his Aghanim Scepter, but just doesn't have the survivability to compete up against a Winter's Curse being deployed and a Sonic Wave. The Shadow Fiend really does need someone like a Sven in that fight. Like, Undying should be that hero, but he just isn't, simply because he can't cause much havoc because he's really comfortable with. The Sven needs to be at least drawing some attention away from the Shadow Fiend. Sven is not super tanky at this stage. Like, he is decently bulky, but, you know, definitely not invulnerable, so Artis and Iceberg working together, that's a lot of damage and actually will disrupt the front line of the Dire quite a bit. Just a Stormhammer, that's really all they need. And of course the Warcry doesn't exactly hurt either. Iceberg is once again on the hunt, but it seems like they're just staking out the map to go for Roshan. Unfortunately, this is not the best timing since Nightstalker is not yet at his Ags. If they had Aghanim, this would be so safe. But they're going to start it up. It's going pretty quickly, but at the same time, SBW are closing in. There's no BKB on the Shadow Fiend, and Nachik does not have his Winter's Curse, actually. The smoke is going to be popped. They're going to go for Vanskor. That's great for Vanskor if he's able to draw the attention away. There's the Aegis Claim. Vanskor going to try to TP out of here. He should not be able to. He's going to get vacuumed back. Tombstone up on the high ground. Nachik is going to get dropped first thing. They get Stormhammer to Madden, but a nice Sonic Wave through 3 is going to drop them all, especially Artis, who has yet to pop his BKB. He's going to lose the Aegis first. That's what he's waiting for. Queen of Pain still in the back lines right now. They're going to get on top of the Nightstalker, who just can't compete up against all these Phantom Lancer illusions. Archie's going to jump right back in. Two-man Stormhammer. The Raze is coming through as well. Iceberg's in a clean house. Now they're on to Urn. Can he get away from here? Udinova is going to come again from the backside. Scream Panthers always want to fly. Will blink out of there. They just don't have the proper crowd control. Not the Night Stalker and Lion have dropped. I don't think they'll be able to get any more of these kills. Although Shadow Fiend is definitely going to try to go for Udinova. He's just not fast enough to compete with that blink. Everyone else should disengage cleanly. Ultimately, it's a 3-for-3 if you do count the Aegis. I don't think these illusions are going to get the kill and always want to fly. But this Sven and Shadow Fiend, they crucially survive. And that is really what matters for CIS Rejects.
I think the problem there was that the Dire just didn't want to intercept the Roche. I don't know if it's because they didn't know Roche was happening or what, but instead going for that target onto the high ground, they could have just had the Winter Wyvern check out the Roche bit in the mid lane though. Winter's Curse onto Iceberg, and he's definitely going to turn into an Iceberg now. Quick takedown. Unfortunately, he wasn't expecting all the reinforcement, but I feel like they should have intercepted the Roche at least, just to make the... because the fight would have...
Hello? A Wyvern's gratitude.
I feel like just disrupting Roche and potentially stealing it themselves would have been much more easy to execute for them, but instead going for that sort of play, and it,
I mean, they also didn't know that Roshan was being taken. I mean, they had an inkling, but they didn't know for sure. They probably should have checked, but if you see a free kill like that, it is hard to say, okay, no, let the Lion go. We need to make sure that Roshan is in the clear right now. They're gonna smoke up and they're gonna run into Goretz, who's still close to his Aghanim Scepter, but he's not gonna get it. Vacuum back. He's gonna get the silence onto Udinova. That's not gonna do anything. And CIS Rejects just bleeding out with their heroes right now. That was also, by the way, Winter Wyvern setting up a gank with the Shadow Amulet, which is something we very rarely see. They know that someone's up on top, although Sven is gonna TP back to base. He'll be just fine. Sven also did not use his BKB in the last fight, so this Sven is working with, you know, full effectiveness. But CIS Rejects, 21-22, this is not the state of the game where they expected themselves to be in right now. They at least want to have the Aghanim Scepter completed at this stage in the game. They are going to become more and more reliant on the Sven as this game progresses.
They're already reliant on the Sven if you really look at it, because the rest of the team, it's just there to really help him get onto his targets, or you could say for some of their heroes, just to play bait, which is what Fly's really doing for his team. He's not really contributing aside from just being bait, keeping himself alive, and just drawing attention to him, and also using Tombstone, you know, undying things. So, as long as they can get those kills going into Arthez's pockets, I think they're golden. Because Sven in the late game, if you compare a Sven to a lot of other carries in his department, Sven does it the best. Because he doesn't need many items to do damage. He just needs strength, which is going to make him tanky. Bladder also correlates to stuff when he pops that God Strength, so it's not bad having a Sven. He just has chasing issues. Once he gets past that, he's a monster.
Lion, Nightstalker, and soon, eventually, I hope, Flesh Golem as well. Arties won't really need to chase. Yes, the Lion does have a gem. Should be shipping it to the Nightstalker soon, if Goretz can ever, you know, actually get his Aghanim Scepter. The gem is right now just on the courier. We have a crit on the Sven as well. The Dire side, they have to, I think, reserve either Sonic Wave or Winter's Curse, ideally both, to effectively deal with this guy. If you do drop that curse on him, then, well, he's obviously not going to be doing any damage to you, but that's probably the best chance that SPW have at bringing down Arties in a convincing fashion. If they bring the Sven down, that's a lot of damage from CIS Rejects down the tubes. He's a 12,000 net worth hero, and Vandal Lancer is looking for that gold. He is doing pretty well for himself. Defusal Blade, we can already see tearing that Nightstalker to shreds, but Mantis Style afterwards, things can get really bad for CS Rejects soon. They have the Aghanim Scepter now flying out to the Nightstalker that is with Gem and with level 2 ultimate as well, and it seems like they want to also smoke up at the same time. So I like this timing from CIS Rejects. I'm pretty sure the Dire, though, are going to be expecting this, as they're smoked up as well. This is going to actually be a target towards Arties. Now he's going to get out of there. I think these smokes may just run around each other.
No, I don't
they're
going to
run right into each other. Akela is running upriver. Goretz is going to see him first off. Darkness not popped just yet. Arty's going to jump in. Going for the Lestrak. Cleaving throw into Nachik as well. That's instant 2-kill. Walk drops onto 3. Not bad there, but even with a good Sonic Wave, the Mechanism's going to nullify all that. They're onto Madden with the Soul Rip. Couple more right clicks will get that kill. Now they're chasing forward for Urn, who already uses Doppelganger. He's going to get torn to shreds. And Queen of Pain, she's going to have no part. Through a Sonic Wave, that's all she can do. CIS Reject with the explosiveness of the Sven start that fight out 5v3.
That was with the help of just a Crystallis and a BKB. This is what you get when you get a Sven with just these couple of items. So I'm pretty sure the Dire, they weren't expecting that coming out from CIS Rejects. And now that they're down these heroes, this high ground push is coming, and this is going to force out a couple of buybacks at least. I feel like the PL is going to have to buy back if they want to defend these Raxes. Because by the time this glyph goes down and these heroes respawn, there's going to be no Raxes. Oh my god, Akela just gets jumped on and two-shot by Artez. There is a Sonic Wave, and it looks like we have our Queen of Pain hoping to do something for the team, but the Sven can be healed up. There's also going to be the Lance thrown out by the PL, and Winter's Curse as well. Lots of commitment to kill Artez, but there's going to be a beautiful stun by Vanskor to keep the PL in place, and it gets blown up. That's a dieback vacuum by Madden. It's not really going to do too much. He sits right in the middle of a Shadow Fiend Requiem. That turned on its head. The overcommitment onto Sven and not being able to kill him off in time really costs them. So both, well, just the PL that bought back is now down with gold and also down for 40 seconds.
Now they're going to try to go for these Raxes. Iceberg still does a lot of damage to these buildings since the buildings do not run away. He's going to grab the Range Rax, then get out of there. Udonova is going to jump right in. Spike a little bit late, but they still will catch him. So he's going to get embraced up, and Iceberg gets stunned by Akela, who finally is able to get some skills off. Will also drop the Shadow Fiend. It's a tier 3 Range Rax, a buyback from the Phantom Lancer, yet it's an okay hold here from SVW. I don't know if they could rely on that every single time. Like, Akela is just so soft right now. Glimmer Cape, though nice, doesn't really do that much when there's an Aghanim Night Stalker running around with the gem. And he's actually just dying in like 2 or 3 hits to the Sven. This Lestrak support needs health.
Yeah, it definitely does. The Darkseer bought back as well, so whatever advantage they had, just take 800 away. So it's not as big as it could have been. I feel like CIS Rejects, because they lost those heroes, it was a little bit of a blow. But considering they got their objective, it means that if they want to, they can just shift into another lane, because the creep wave is always going to push in that mid lane.
Perhaps go for a top lane tier 2, something that the Dire may not be willing to make a defense for. As for other items that CIS Rejects may be waiting for, we have an ultimate orb being built by the Shadow Fiend, but he is very far away from actually completing that. Undying is going to go for an Aghanim Scepter. They did change this. It was before, I believe, Flesh Golem amplifying just a little bit more. Now it's Decay stealing, I believe, 10 strength. So, yeah, Decay is going to be hurting a lot, but still, I'm not quite sure if this is going to make Always Wanna Fly super relevant. He is going to, you know, take 10 strength for himself. So there's a lot of upside to be had here. This is the first time I'm going to see it, and I hope it works out well, because that just seems pretty awesome.
It's not just going to be 10 strength. Like, if he gets 3 heroes, that's 30 strength. That's huge, right? Or is that not how it works?
I think it should be how it works, unless I misread it. I mean, that is how Decay usually works. I don't think they would change it once...
So imagine, one strike, he gets 30 strength, and then maybe hits 2 other heroes. That's 50 stolen strength. He's going to be so tanky. You look at it into perspective, that's huge compared to the 4 strength deal he does currently. So I'm really excited to see this on the Undying.
I just love when Aghanim Scepter becomes viable on a hero that it was trash on before. Like, mm-hmm. We see Nightstalker Aghanim Scepter when that was implemented. People love that, and we can see it's doing its job right now. Full map vision here on the Dire Jungle with Iceberg shoving the creep wave. He has the Scotty actually completed drop air. Did let us know that there was a second ultimate orb on the courier, and there's also the workings of an AC there. Artez almost has that one completed. Just needs the recipe, and he'll be good to go. Top lane, not going to be pushed. In fact, we have a smoke up for CIS Rejects. I like this, just a feign push, and then slide into some other area. Wait for some sort of defense, maybe even jump in the base, but it seems like they're going to make a beeline for the bottom lane. Oh, they're going to hold their smoke for right now. They're just waiting for some poor sucker to defend mid lane. Looks like that poor sucker is going to be this Winter Wyvern. Oh, where's the Nightstalker, actually? He is not in a position to see the Wyvern. Now they're going to go for Madden. Can't see him either. Yeah, Nightstalker, if he was closer to the stairs, they could have jumped in, slayed the Winter Wyvern, and then be on their way.
They do have vision in the base now, and Artez, gets a beautiful double stun. It's going to be on the Wyvern as well as the PL. The PL just gets obliterated. There's also a wall, and Queen of Pain already blew everything and running away from the Sven. This is not something that you don't really want to have happen. And the Leshrac just going to try and man up here and do a little bit of damage to Artez, but he's going to be healed up by Fly. He is still alive for a little bit longer, but there's the Winter's Curse. BKB was already used, so it looks like he is definitely going to go down here. Blink in by the Queen of Pain and scream down to death, but the rest of CIS Rejects are going to be cleaning up these heroes. Queen of Pain, Madden, and looks like Nosik, if he's not lucky, he's going to get picked down as well. Looks like he will. Shot down to hell by Shadow Fiend, and all of a sudden, CIS Rejects win another team fight off the back of a beautiful stun by the Sven.
two men in that, the Phantom Lancer being involved there as well, is just disastrous for the SPW side. They both did not stand a chance. There's a two-man spike to follow up with that stun as well. Now we see the Undying. How much strength can he get? It retroactively changed his decay to 10 strength. That might just be a graphical glitch, but either way, Undying is going to be really big. He's going to lose all that strength, though, so he's not very healthy right now. But Iceberg, he is very healthy, and he's just going to go to work on the top lane. Melee mid lane has already been taken. Vanxcore is going to use his kit to clear out as many illusions as he can. Fortification is there. Akela is going to approach without the blinking Sven. It's a lot more difficult to actually get the kill on the Lashrak, but they'll circle around with the Shadow Fiend and Shadow Blade, get right on top of the Phantom Lancer, force him to doppelgang out, and then finish off the melee racks. Tombstone now deployed, which also did survive for a large time in the last fight, and will survive for a little while longer this time. Top lane, undefendable here for SVW. They lose two Raxes, and now CIS Rejects, firmly in control of this game, are going to back off, probably go towards Roshan, but pretty much no matter what they do, they'll have the assistance of a ton more items. There's 4,000 gold on this Shadow Fiend.
I think for the Dire to come back, they're going to have to throw the combo of their life. Just go for the Curse, Wall, Sonic Wave, just everything in one shot. Hopefully they kill a couple of heroes from CIS Rejects during the events and maybe win it off the back of that, but they're so far behind in terms of items. If they just go for a straight on 5-on-5 engagement, I don't see them winning because the Shadow Fiend's so tanky, the Sven is so tanky, there's just not enough damage left in the tank for the Dire to take everyone down at a decent timing. They just have to make sure they focus fire a specific target and hope that they have enough to deal with whoever's left. And you don't want the Sven to be the last one standing.
Sven is always the first one to drop, but he is tanky enough to make it so that while you're trying to kill the Sven, you're struggling to do so, first of all, and Iceberg is just wailing at you. 5k now on the Shadow Fiend, and a double life on the Night Stalker. I guess the Sven doesn't really have item slots to spare at this point. He's grabbed an Assault Cuirass, so you know, can't really blame him for that, but here comes the death blow, at least attempted death blow from CIS Rejects. It's right down the bottom lane, they're going to go. Lashrak's gonna grab a Yule Scepter. Between that and Glimmer Cape, he has a chance of surviving, but he does not have enough sustained to survive through a Stormhammer if he gets hit with it. Arty's gonna get cursed right now. Jump forward, vacuum only onto one right now. Tombstone gets deployed, shouldn't last for that long. Arty's gonna hit with the Winter's Curse. His allies are beating him down right now. Assault Crest gonna hold for only a little while. He's going to fall. This is looking like a pretty good defense for the Dire. Always want to fly in the middle of everything. Stealing quite a bit of strength, but still he's being completely swamped by illusions. He will survive for a little while longer. Has another decay and another soul rip for himself. They do eventually drop the Night Stalker, but Iceberg, he's under no pressure whatsoever. Someone has to take care of the Shadow Fiend. He'll walk back and forth through the wall. He doesn't really give a damn. Now he's going to find Nachik. One shot, two shot, raise to get the kill. Winter Wyvern still paper at this stage, and Iceberg grabs a Daedalus straight up with that 5k gold. The wall is going to prevent them from comfortably moving forward into this base, but Phantom Lancer, Queen of Pain, it's going to be a tough defense from them. Sven, he got locked down completely. That's what SBW have to do. But clearly, it's just not enough right now. With the Darkseer buying back, they have a chance at actually defending this decently. Always want to fly, gonna start stealing a little bit of strength. They're gonna jump forward, Sonic Wave with the Vacuum, but it's just not gonna do enough. It killed off the Undying, but Iceberg is still standing strong. Will kill off the Queen of Pain with a big crit. Will eventually drop, as Urn is not going to die just yet. Goritz is going to make his retreat. It's a hold for SVW. It's an expensive hold, but CIS Rejects, I'm pretty sure they're not gonna stop. The game plan is the same.
I was very surprised that they decided to hang around. Honestly, when you see three heroes up on high ground like that, and you have a couple of heroes on your team that are at half HP, quarter HP, it would have been the much safer option to back up, wait for your teammates, and just go again. But going for that kind of play, it's kind of punished. Undying stole 40 strength at one time during... Oh my goodness. How much HP does 40 strength give you? Give me them stats.
Well,
what are them stats?
40 times 19... Yeah, that's a lot. Almost 800.
Well, drop Bill, throw us the stats. Hopefully he can do the math for us. But
You can do the math. Don't be lazy.
Math's not for me, bro. Sorry. I can't do math.
40 times 19. It's, 760. Wow, get wrecked, Drop Bear. Get wrecked. Try to out-math me, please. It's a lot of HP for the Undying to grab all at once. As long as his Sven is still alive, also having that armor aura nearby means that that HP is that much more difficult to grind through. Not to mention the fact that Flesh Golem is going to be very difficult to remove here from the Dire. Arty's He's gonna get spotted by Nautic right now. Artifern is there. Here comes Madden, but Sven is pissed. He's gonna pop the BKB. They finger death on Madden. He's still gonna survive even through the spike, but it's gonna be Unova in the most trouble. They're gonna drop the curse onto Artis, but he's still surviving, and he can take these heroes on 1v5. No big deal, especially with Undying coming in. They're gonna get the heals onto Artis. Sonic Wave through still. He is taking a lot of damage, but he's doing a lot as well. Unova surviving just barely. Spike onto 2 as CSVJ's trying to disengage. Where's Iceberg? They really need the Shadow Fiend because Urn is running wild. They're going to get onto Always Wanna Fly, who is very, very tanky at this stage, but not that tanky. Now, finally, Iceberg's making his arrival in. A couple of big crits with Gorath also coming in. Nautic has nowhere to run. He's going to embrace himself, but that's not how you escape the situation. He'll drop in a 3-for-2 exchange. Sven and Undying putting up a hell of a fight before they go down. Phantom Lancer does have a buyback, and I think he's going to have to use it. How the hell did this creep wave get behind the Radiant creep wave? I have no idea, but still, with Iceberg being at full HP, doing so much damage, this tower is going to take an absolute beating.
Yeah, I'm surprised how that creep wave got there. I guess they cleared it out or something. But in the meantime, though, we have a bit of action in that bottom lane, and they have to pop the glyph. They need to delay this for as long as possible, and you never want your PL to buy back, ever. Although Madden, on the other hand, he has a couple of other plans. He blinked and takes a ton of damage, has to pop his Guardian Greaves, and all of a sudden, combo doesn't land on the Leshcrack, unfortunately, but Madden, he might get crit. He doesn't in the end, though, and we have the Night Stalker just making a getaway, whereas Iceberg gets a kill on the Leshcrack before he dies. They're doing a very good job at defending, and unfortunately, Udinova won't find that kill, although in the meantime, Vanskor gonna be spotted by the PL. He's just gonna get bursted down by these two heroes as well, so rest in pieces, my friend Vanskor.
He bought back. He needs to not die here. He's going into an area where he knows there are at least four enemy heroes. Looks like he's not gonna die back just yet. Always Wanna Fly, as well as Artis, both alive and both incoming. But CIS Rejects want this game to end right now. They are kind of just carelessly going into these fights, like, one at a time. At least not as a full five-man team. That is pretty much how you lose this game. And yes, Leshrac was taking some big crits on the SF. As long as CIS Rejects play this slowly, I still think they have it. But, you know, just charging in and throwing bodies into the enemy base, that is a great way to throw this lead. It's still not impossible to see the entire side come back into it.
Absolutely, like the way CIS have been playing, they've been throwing bodies at the Raxes, or not even Raxes, at heroes, and it's really costing them. So this is giving a chance for the Tyre to come back, which is very scary if you look at it through CIS Rejects' perspective, which is why they just keep pressuring that bottom lane. There is going to be a bit of harassment onto Iceberg, but Queen of Pain can't really commit because there is a chance she could just get crit down by the Shadow Fiend. So what does CIS do now? They're not really staying together. They're kind of all over the place. Nightstalker will be rotating down towards the bottom, whereas Sven's still farming the jungle. Are they waiting for Roche by any chance?
That is the safest thing to do here from CIS Rejects. If you just get as much farm as you can, maybe get the Sven another item. Looks like that will be upgraded crit into Daedalus. There's really no rush. Like, the two Raxes down mean that CIS Rejects are going to be getting more gold from killing off the Dire Creeps, and they, of course, have access to both jungles at this stage. Or they could just go for the jugular, but Iceberg is kind of far away for that. See, this is what they shouldn't be doing, putting Always Wanna Fly in with the rest of the team nowhere close. Now that they're all together, here we go. RT is going to get the Mjolnir charge popped, and he's going to get two with the stun again. God Strength popped. Madden's going to survive, but not for much longer. Udinova, he's going to be forced to blink out immediately. Buyback from the Winter Wyvern right now, but Iceberg and RT is both at full HP, and Urn's taking a beating right now. He can't raise Iceberg. He'll drop with no buyback available. Nautic's going to jump in for the curse and Always Want to Fly, who's going to take a little bit of damage, but he's stolen so much strength that he is going to survive right through it. And it looks like, finally, with CIS Rejects assembling all the troops at the same time, will end this game.
Well, there was a good fight put up by the Dire, but just, it wasn't enough. The power coming out from the Sven, and as well as the Shadow Fiend, and how tanky those heroes were, they just didn't have enough damage left when it came to trying to killing all of them. I wish I knew what that meant. CIS Rejects.
I think it means you got wrecked by us. Get wrecked, noobs.
No. I think pretty he was sure talking
that's
about
the direct
fly.
Translation.
Oh, definitely. I'm pretty sure he was saying something about fly. He said fly, so maybe they'll say
like upset about his tombstone. I'd be so pissed if tombstone worked like that, and I had no idea. But guys, this is game one. SBW have another shot to bring it back, but it's going to hopefully involve a Leshrac that does a little more, Winter Wyvern that does a little more. I'm Mike Larson, joined by Danley Cast and Corrupt Drop Bear on the mic and stats, and we'll both be right back.